So, Gary, we have about 30 minutes, and
Okay.
it's all yours. Would you like to introduce yourself and present the presentation?
Yeah.
Make the presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, I will. Okay, hello. Thank you very much for having the opportunity to present our BOS model. And first, I would like to introduce my colleagues here with me. Actually, we sit in my office, and my colleague Moshe Avidan, who has developed a computerized system to support this model that I worked off. And also, I have Alejandro with me, who is our computer specialist that I have asked him to join us in order to keep the system up, so in case of problems. So thanks, Alejandro and Moshe, for being here today. And I would like, before I start actually the presentation, to say a few words about my professional career. I am an industrial engineer in 3 degrees. The first 2 degrees I got at the Technion in Haifa. The PhD I got at USC in Los Angeles, and I graduated in 1981, actually 34 years ago. I worked for many years in industry, in various types of industries, and about 15 years ago, I joined the Ruppin Academic Center, and I developed here a School of Engineering. And today, in this School of Engineering, we have 4 departments: industrial engineering, which is my area, computer engineering, electrical engineering, and biomedical engineering. Total of about 1,000 students. Now, as I said, for many years I worked in manufacturing. And one of the basic assets in manufacturing is the bill of materials. And we used it for daily work. And it turns to be that about 8 years ago, I started to work in the service area by doing a major project in one of the hospitals not far from here. It's the Hillel Yaffe Hospital. And I was lucky, I would say, to be to try and understand actually how service shop floors work. And finally, after a few years, I've decided that I would like to try and use some ideas from manufacturing. And one of the ideas was to develop a kind of bill of materials in manufacturing. And as I said, I have defined it as a bill of services. And then I will now, with this kind of brief introduction, I will go step by step through the presentation. Okay. I would say a few words in general regarding the world of services. Then I want to spend maybe 1 minute and memorize the gap model. And then I'll go straight to talk about the service concept. What is the service concept? Like a product concept or similar methodology. And then I say a few words about the bill of materials. As I said, it was my reference to the bill of services. And then we'll continue with going into details and explain and present the bill of services and how we can use it. Finally, we show a real-life example. Actually, It's a product of one of the projects of my students in the basic course in service engineering, and we'll end with summarizing this presentation. About the world of services, as we actually know, we would like all the time to get valuable service delivery and meet our customers' expectations and requirements and demand. And we should deliver our service when it's needed and to the complete satisfaction of the customer. And here, I would like to get right the way to the point, which is, I would say, the main product of using the bill of services, which is planning the service capacity, where I would say it's obvious that excess capacity is very good for the customer, but it turns to be that it may get to extra costs, and insufficient capacity will produce long waiting time. And the question is, where are we between these two extremes? Here we have the gap model, and just to go through, this is actually a basic schematic model presenting the complexity of delivering a service. And if we go clockwise, starting from customer expectations, because before we start the service, our customer has any expectations. Then we go to the next step, where management kind of percepts the customer expectations. Right at this point, we have gap number one. Going further, once the management understood or kind of understood the customer expectations, they design the service, and then we have the service standards. And here again, maybe that there is a gap because we understood the expectations, but finally, according to management constraints, we decided about specific service standards. Going further, we have the service standards, but we have the actual service delivery, which may create another gap. And if we go further, we have the service delivery and how the customer perceives this service, which can cause another gap. And finally, gap number five is the gap between the initial customer expectations and what he got and how he is satisfied. So this kind of model, to me, it's a very interesting and presents the whole idea of designing a service and designing by means of allocating resource capacities in order to get the customer what he would like to get. The next step is the service concept. And as I said, here what I've done is a kind of analogy to a product concept, where we define actually three levels. The first level is a set of benefits to be delivered to the customer. The second level is third set of service components to support each benefit. And the third level is set of processes or technologies or facilities to support each component. Now, I believe that as I was experienced in industry, in manufacturing, if an organization defines the service concept according to these three levels, it should be that the service delivery will be according to what the customer needs and what the company has decided. The next thing is that according to the service concept, we define the service specifications. And as you see here, I right away introduce the kind of bill of services or a kind of a tree structure. And for every given concept element, we define the necessary procedures to ensure conformance with customer expectations. And if we look at this very simple tree, we have a kind of service specification. For each service specification, we have a set of service characteristics. And for each service characteristic, we have a service level. Just to give an example, I would say that if we are talking, let's say, in a service in a restaurant, so one of the service characteristics may be the time to get an order from a customer, okay? So this is the characteristic, and then the service level will be that something like in 80% of the cases, that will be less than 2 minutes or less than 4 minutes or less than 5 minutes and so forth. So this is a very simple example for what I mean by service specification, service characteristics, and service level. Now, as you see the line under the tree, I wrote the different service levels require varying resource capacity in order to comply with the given service characteristics. And this is actually the great dilemma in every organization that delivers services. And here we say, the operational dilemma actually is we have a service specification, it should comply with the customer expectations, but it should satisfy management ability to allocate the needed resources or capacity slash budget in order to satisfy the service characteristic. This is actually the dilemma, and as we'll see in 2 minutes, the BOS model actually was developed in order to support the management to get a kind of a response to this dilemma. Next slide, I will talk few words just to memorize what is the bill of materials, and then we go further to the bill of services. So just only to memorize, the bill of materials is a kind of a tree structured mechanism containing all the products and components of the product. And as we see here, we have a set of levels. In each level, we have various type of components. It may be from a discrete component to a part to a sub-assembly, and this is the hierarchy of the product. Now, again, just to recall, we use the bill of materials for two purposes. One purpose is to get a list of components in order to support purchasing, in order to support inventory management. And the other purpose is the production planning and control. We actually create work orders, and the work orders are according to the levels of the tree. And now, finally, we approach our bill of services, and the structure is kind of similar to the structure of the bill of materials, but the idea is a little bit different, and I will, of course, explain. As we see here, we have at the top the service organization, and for example, the service organization is, let's say, a hotel. And if we talk a hotel, then we have a set of categories. One category for example, housekeeping. Another category is restaurants. Another category may be spa. Another category may be office services, and so forth and so forth. And then for each category, we go further and we define the service characteristics. And for each service characteristic, we define the service level. What we would like to get with the bill of services, once we develop a detailed structure like that, is we can define the type of jobs needed or type of professions needed in order to satisfy the definitions of this tree. And finally, according to various service levels, we can kind of conduct simulations or sensitivity analysis and find out how many units of resource A or resource B we need in order to satisfy a specific tree. And again, a tree includes various service categories. Each category contains service characteristics. Each service characteristic is defined by a service level. And this finally kind of we can calculate for a given service category and characteristic in service level, what would be the number of resources needed in order to satisfy that. What we see in this slide is a kind of a general methodology once we have or we can use the BOSS in any service organization. And as we see here, we start with our customer needs and expectations. Then remember the gap model. Then we define the service specifications. For each specification, we define service characteristics and the service level. And finally, we have the BOSS. We can then conduct simulations or sensitivity analysis, and finally make a decision what will be the service capacity. And the service capacity derives what will be the service costing, okay? And finally, we go back to the customer, and he gets, or we deliver the service for his needs. And I will end my presentation with a short example. As I said, it's a product of one of the projects of a team of students in my course of service engineering that we have in the undergraduate program of industrial engineering. And what we see here, we see an example of bill of services tree of our library at Rupin Academic Center. And what we see here, that in our library, we have in the category level, we have set of categories. We have training. The staff of the library are conducting an ongoing process. They conduct training either for students or for staff. We have all kinds of support services like copying machines, scanning, printing, and so forth. We have front desk services, which contains a loan and return of books, assisting in shelf search, and of course, a phone response. We have consulting, mainly staff members of the library who assist staff members and students to find mainly, I would say, articles in the scientific literature. And then we have material order, either ordering new books for the library or papers for according to the need, especially for a staff member. So this is the tree of our library, and I'm going further in order to show what actually we are doing with the boss model. And just for that, I don't want to take the whole complex. We took only the category of front desk services, and this is what you see in this slide. We have the category of front desk services, and the front desk services, as we see, we have three type of characteristics. We have loan and return, we have phone response, and we have shelf search. And if I go to the next slide, what we see here is actually data, I mean real life data that students found out when they worked in the library. And what we see here, we see what is the duration in order to conduct loan or return or shelf search or phone response. We see what is the rate of arrivals per hour. And then finally, we conduct some calculation to get the weighted average. As you see, we defined the BOSS model can support, if we talk about a service organization, we have various, for example, rate of arrivals during different days or during different hours of the day. So as you see here in this example, we defined it here in two categories. We defined it in weekdays and defined it on Fridays, because usually, you know, Friday in Israel is a shorter day. So usually the arrivals are less than in the usual day. And as you see in the table, the figures are quite different. But the boss supports it, so there is no problem to define it. You can even define every hour a different rate of arrivals. Okay. At this table, it's a kind of going into details to what we have seen before. And as you see here, the first up two lines, we have the front desk services, and we have divided it into weekdays and Fridays. And as you see, we defined a weighted average for the duration of response. And then if we go further in the table, the third line is talking about services on Sunday between 8 to 10 in the morning. As we see, we have 6 arrivals, continuing from 10 to 6 in the evening, we have 10 arrivals on the average, and then from 6 to 8 o'clock, we have 6 arrivals. So this is a kind of a very flexible possibility. So we can, as I said, define in various hours in the day or in various days during the week, we can define different arrival rates, or maybe the duration of response is different. It is very flexible. The idea is that we would like to get as far as possible the needed capacity for each resource. And the next slide shows us the results of making a kind of sensitivity analysis. What I will show here, I will show just two measurements. One measurement is the average response per arrival, as we see here, versus capacity. And if we look on the graphs, we see that for one, that the horizontal axis is the capacity of librarians. If we have one librarian and the duration is starting with the blue line, the duration is 2 minutes, what we see that we don't have any kind of waiting time. But if we go further and the responsiveness is 4 minutes, and 4 minutes it's the yellow line, as we see, one librarian and 4 minutes of response time creates waiting time per shift. The figures are here per shift, a waiting time of 120 minutes. If the service duration is 5 minutes, as we see, with one librarian in one shift, we have total waiting time of 239 minutes, okay? Now, if we take a capacity of two librarians, as we see, that it doesn't matter what is the duration time, we don't have any waiting time. So this is really a very simple example, but just to show the idea how our system works. And the next slide shows a very similar kind of a complement of the first measurement. Here we are talking about idle time, because as we said before, we don't want that the customer will wait too much, but we don't want that the service operator will be idle too much. And this is actually the dilemma. So these two slides or these two measurements show us what happens if we have one librarian or two librarians regarding the waiting time. And this is just to explain what is the power of this BOS model when we want to do this kind of sensitivity analysis. And to summarize, I would say that for a given concept or service category, service characteristics, and service level, the bill of services support management with calculating or allocating resources capacity, calculating the related costs, of course, and gives us the possibility to conduct sensitivity analysis. And with this slide, we got to the end of our presentation, and I would like to thank you very much. And if there are any questions, we'll be glad to answer.
Oh, Professor Gad, this was perfect timing. Thank you very much for this great presentation. So, do we have any questions, comments? I have one question and a comment.
Okay.
Looks like we are using the queuing theory, right? For when we are looking at the waiting time.
It's
When we go to, I think it was one of the earlier slides, when we go from the benefit to the characteristics
okay.
for the service, you know, I mean, I couldn't figure out the level of granularity, right? If we divide it.
One second, I'll go back to this slide.
The 13.
Yeah. Okay.
From category we have, and then from category we have characteristics, and then goes to service level. So one thing I've been thinking, how we can define the granularity of these categories, and even underneath the category, the service characteristics, right? How many level we may need to go, or how much we need to capture, keep it as a summary level.
Actually, you can end with three levels, like in this schematic structure, but it may be even more than that.
Right. It is kind of hard to figure out the optimum level, right? If we have too many, complexity goes up. If we have high level, then we cannot capture the details.
It was right. But what we have done, and I have quite a lot of real life examples in different types of organizations. And actually, I remember we were talking about maybe writing a book that you and Jim are editing this publication. And then I believe that when I write this kind of book, I can give various type of examples using the BOSS model.
Right. So, do we have any other questions, comments?
This is Steve.
Hi, Steve. Good morning.
Hi. Thanks for the presentation. I'm also looking at slide 13. I think that this type of model can be used also in the modeling subcontracting when you have a service that's being delivered by subcontractors or other people in the service network, in which case you
have... You are absolutely right. Okay. I agree. It's a very good observation. Yeah, absolutely right.
Okay. So I did send you... I sent you an email with a paper that we have a very similar concepts.
Okay.
Contracting and also using partners... You know, like different companies use partners in delivering the service breaking it down into components. And the problem is, we always face the problem is that your partners and your subcontractors do not fulfill the contract that you proposed to your customer.
Right. Yeah, but I agree. It's really, as I said, a very good observation. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, do we have any other questions, comments? We are a couple of minutes after our timeline. Okay, Professor Gad, thank you very much again for your time and for being available to present this great research. And thank you, everybody, for this morning, and have a wonderful day.
Thank you very much, Alok, and it was my pleasure to have the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you.